It is time to experience a different radio station in digital broadcasting, WKIT. Pyramid One World Radio Network with broadcaster Bob Charles. Our programming is based on truth, faith, and love. We have studios in Florida, Texas, and Australia. So let's begin into subjects that change our perceptions about the world around you and I. Question Bob Charles received here on Pyramid One World Radio. That question was, are there any other ascended masters like Jesus? Yes, in various spiritual traditions, there are many beings referred to as ascended masters who are considered to have reached a high level of spiritual enlightenment and mastery. These figures are believed to have transcended the cycle of rebirth and now exist in a higher spiritual realm, guiding humanity. Some of the most commonly recognized ascended masters besides Jesus include Buddha, the founder of Buddhism, who achieved enlightenment and is often revered as an ascended master. Saint German, a mystical figure associated with the teachings of Theosophy and the I Am movement. He is often considered the master of the seventh ray, representing freedom, mercy, and transmutation. Kuan Yin, a bodhisattva in Mahayana Buddhism, known as the goddess of compassion and mercy, often recognized as an ascended master. Melchizedek, a biblical figure mentioned in the Old Testament, who is sometimes considered an ascended master and a high priest of spiritual knowledge. Sanat Kumara, a being of light in theosophical teachings, said to be a guide and protector of Earth. El Moria, believed to be the Chohan of the first ray of will and power, and associated with the teachings of Theosophy and the ascended master teachings. Mother Mary, the mother of Jesus, who many Christians revered and esoteric traditions as an ascended master, representing divine feminine energy and compassion. Krishna, a deity in Hinduism who is often considered an incarnation of Vishnu, is recognized in some spiritual circles as an ascended master. These figures come from a range of spiritual traditions, and while they are considered ascended masters by some, they might be seen differently within their respective religions. The concept of ascended masters is more prominent in New Age, Theosophical, and esoteric teachings. Are we experiencing oneness with the Ascended Master? The concept of oneness with Ascended Masters is rooted in the idea that all beings are interconnected on a spiritual level, and that we are ultimately expressions of the same divine source. Experiencing oneness with an Ascended Master means recognizing and feeling a deep spiritual connection with these enlightened beings, who are seen as guides or teachers on the path of spiritual evolution.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah. We're going old school manual.
You know, it's so funny that I played that at work today, and it was so funny because we have like two, I don't know, they're like 5-foot by 6-foot TVs on both sides of the walls and everything else. So we plugged into one of them with the cell phone, plugged it in. And, you know, I played it. For everybody, I said to you guys, you know, I said, you know, you guys said, you know, talk about this and that and the other thing. And I said, here's something that I did. Tell me what you think. I never saw five people with mouths open, did not move at all. All five clapped when it was all done. I'm sitting there going, yeah. The guy said, where the hell did you get that from? I said, a lot of research.
Yeah, huh? Excellent.
See, the hard part is they don't nowhere. To the people that are listening right now, and I can see that somebody's listening right now. That's good. I'll be with you in just a second. But so many people don't realize how many people that we did. See, when you asked me that with the Ascended Masters, people don't realize that there were like super, you know, masters, not just the one of the ways, you know, the super guys, the guys that really, really, really were ascended masters. They weren't born. They weren't born with the tattooed on their chest. I'm an ascended master. No, they didn't do any of that kind of stuff. They were really, really, really people that foresaw us as a humanity. All of them, including Mary. You know, and I mean, you know, it's just, I mean, especially when you look it up. I mean, don't look it up on Google. It took me a long time, you know. I mean, here I am. I'm sitting at a Burger King, and I'm going to get a burger, and I'm sitting there looking for Mary and Ascended Master on my phone. People must have thought I was completely, totally out of my gourd. But, you know, to put that together, if people play this show and keep listening to that clip, they will also notice that there's more to life than just, you know, going to work and coming home. There's a lot.
Yes. We've just gotten so distracted. This is what you do. You go to work. You got to make the money to pay the bills. Just for my awareness. So it keeps us distracted and very focused in other directions. Being able to open up the best that we can for this spiritual knowledge, because everyone has the ability to tap in. It's just most don't. And it's that kind of connection that, you know, JC, just from my awareness, Jesus and Buddha weren't into, I don't believe that they created that. It was the Buddhism was created after Buddha. The churches were created after Jesus. And to my awareness, he was always like, hey, don't walk in front of me. Don't walk behind. Walk by my side because we're equal. And if you have the faith of a mustard seed, you can move mountains. What if that's very real? I always say the seeds of consciousness. What if that first seed is the idea of technology? And in this case, the seed of mustard seed and the faith, now all these years later, we literally have the technology to obliterate locations completely. And it doesn't have to go in that direction,
but it is real. And as in I am, it is.
And that's the two most powerful words in the universe. I am.
Yeah.
I was. Exactly. Right. Yep. Not I will be. I am. And it's that connection that more people are waking up going, okay, you know what? Maybe, just maybe there's more than this third dimensional life experience. I'm like, God bless you. Question everything and be open. And a lot of people are starting to open up to their own awareness in whatever way works for them and is comfortable. And I'm enjoying them thriving in life. Because once they get a little more validation, moving from, oh, the spiritual stuff is the airy fairy, to, oh, maybe there's possibly a little bit more validity to that with that quantum physics and spirituality now becoming spiritual physics, unification, not separation.
And you know, the people that I was talking to, and that now I know them for a couple of years now, most of them anyway, and, you know, they kind of look at you and go, oh, yeah, they're doing the spiritual thing. That was 2 years ago. Today, they're asking me questions. Now, all right, it took a little while. But we also have to realize that even with the last full moon, our frequencies are getting higher. We are getting into a more awake state as far as we are. And we are, there's so many people, look, let's face it. We know what's going on in Washington. It's all kinds of, it's like kindergarten on steroids. I'm serious. It is. Whatever anybody wants to say. But as much as you used to see people that they used to freak out, I mean, I'm talking normal, real, like card carrying, born here Americans. We were the ones that always, if something like this came up, we'd be the first one that would turn around and we'd start, you know, fighting back. And I mean, not only language, but we start throwing bricks. At the same time, you don't see that now. You see people actually making some kind of logical what conclusion of what's going on. They say, okay, you're going to do that now, but I got you. Vote here. You know, I mean, the Americans are putting their logic and their consciousness to work for them instead of the other way around. It's guys like you, Jamie, and you know, I'm sure there's other people in that other word that, you know, just like you, that are like super psychics, and you make sense of things to people. Yeah, like, for instance, Jason was in here, but he had probably had to go and walk his dog. He dropped off. But, you know, the thing is, you know, people have to realize that there's more to life than what you see. I feel things. Now, whether that's a good thing or a bad thing.
It's a good thing.
All right. Whether it's a good thing or a bad thing.
Within that ability. Otherwise, oh, we go off on, you know, Timbuktu going, where the, what the? Yeah. And that's why, yeah, with that feeling, I always say, for me, feelings are different than emotions. A lot of people tend to equate them as similar or the same. And exactly. My thing is they're not. To me, emotions are happy and sad and certain and uncertain kind of thing. Right. Feelings are grasping spiritual aspects, vibrational patterns of energy, things like that. Because on average, when somebody says it, they say it like this, I feel happy or I feel angry. They don't go, I'm happy, happy. It's an acknowledgement. And it's in that grasping of those feelings that you will hear what people say and feel what they mean. It's not judgment. It's understanding the best that we can where that person is at, what they're tuned into, so that we can communicate and talk with them, not just to them. You know, and it's a beautiful dynamic, but a lot of people tend to not necessarily question things. And for me, I'm like, God, please question everything for Jesus. You know, and most people, from my awareness, say that he died for our sins, which is beautiful. But my thing is didn't he come back 3 days later? Isn't that part of, what about the rest of his existence on this planet? Has that, well, for me, nobody questioned. I'm like, God, please, what about that? What if there is lineage? What if there was, as we perceive it, a regular life that he, in this case, was able to help humanity to help itself and be able to enjoy the freedoms of existence? Because we all have parameters, you know, if you're on this human body and this experience, you do things this way, that way, and the other way, which is fine. That's good. So that we kind of have a reference. But as you know, like I do, when we're newborn, as we perceive it, we're pretty much born without teeth, without awareness of this planet, without having to, you know, live and exist type of thing. We're just, I'm just here. And so it becomes the love and compassion of our parents or whomever it is that is able to take us into their life experience and share that knowledge of what they've already been through. But that's a little bit of what Jesus was doing. Hey, what I do, you can do, and even more if you do it. Hey, I stand and knock on all doors of consciousness.
You know what everybody else in that doesn't get either? There was supposedly, I mean, you can take it anyway, an Adam and an Eve. Okay. Adam and Eve was part of Jesus. Part of Jesus is part of us. Every single thing, you get a female and you get a male. The two of them mate. They have two kids. Those two kids had kids, et cetera, et cetera. And the DNA line keeps going and going and going and going and going. And therefore, every single one of us are in one way, well, I can even say half-assed way, relatives.
Yeah, and here, just for me, because I love to question that stuff, do you know when they perceived that Adam and Eve helped to create humanity? Because my thing is if it was maybe 5, 10,000, 20,000 years ago, that's lovely. But to me, genetically, how is it possible that on the angelic realm of this connection of, in this case, Caucasians possibly, or Middle Easterns, whoever it is, that they're going to be able to get Native Americans and Asians and African Americans? I'm like, well, just to me, that's a pretty quick turnaround. And if you can do that kind of growth within a number of thousands of years, we might be vastly ahead of the game and able to present and manifest more than what we're doing. Just a lot of people don't necessarily question it. You know, Adam and Eve, and that's the beginning of it. And I'm like, what about all these other people? Okay. Same thing with the great flood for Noah. My thing is it didn't flood the entire planet. Because if it did, again, how do we have the Asians, the Native Americans, the Africans, you know, all of those dynamics? If it all comes from one boat and it was all underwater, pretty much, if it were that case, what if just potentially that there's a focused area back east in the Middle East that did get, as we perceive it, flooded? It wasn't the entire planet. It was the surrounding area that they didn't go any further than, you know, whatever the area was. And then maybe they thought, well, it's the whole entire world. I'm like, really? What if there's a potential that it could be different than that? Because, you know, I always try to say in a loving way, here's how easy it is to manipulate humanity. Here's who you're going to vote for. Okay. You know.
Well, don't forget it's in the Bible, too. You know, there was a point that everyone got different tongues. And by the name of tongues, it didn't mean that they all spoke different languages. I think they broke into separate tribes. And that tribe, one of the tribes, could have been Asian. And another one could have been Nordic. And another one could have been African. And another one could have been American. Well, what wound up to be Indians here. And that's not only here, but Canada, too. Whole thing was all Indians. So each one of these big land masses, wherever their boats or whatever hit, that's where they made their little nest, and they made their little camps, and they made their little towns, and they made their little babies, and it grew whoever that person was at that particular time, because they had to exist in their own zone with their own people speaking the same language.
And isn't it interesting that I believe that the Native Americans were here before we got here? So in essence, a little bit, we may have taken over the land and given them their own secluded area. This is where you'll be able to have, you know, the casinos and many other things. We'll make sure that you have the opportunity to at least have the up and up on that. And then just little by little, they, as you can see, more than likely, there hasn't been a war with the Native Americans. I share the fact that just for me, I'm half Native American. I'm half Huron from back east, the Native American tribe. And then it's other, you know, English and Welsh kind of thing. But it's really interesting to see that the heritage, where we're growing and where we're going, becomes the language of the communication. Meaning in this case, for us, as we perceive it, the English language is understood by a lot of countries. That seems to be the planetary language. The others are beautiful languages. They just may not be used as much as the English language is.
I was going to say that I'm Germanic.
Yeah, huh?
I never, it's like when I was a little kid. Now, my grandparents did come off the boat. Cool. And, you know, they didn't really, really speak a lot of Germanic at all. You know, but when we were little kids, they did. They experimented. And we knew we could talk it. Of course, you grow up and you forget it. But, you know, the funny part about it is, you know, this is how my whole family was 100% until my kids. Because my wife then was Irish. So then they were German-Irish. What a mix-up.
But yeah.
What a mix up. But anyway, the thing was in my family, up until me and my sister, we're all 100% German all the way down the line.
Notice how you bridged that connection between the Germanic aspect and the American aspect as we perceive it. Now you're going multilingual, multiple languages. Because to me, languages are nothing but mere vibrational patterns on our ear nubs that we've trained ourselves to hear those patterns and apply a meaning. That's why I always say, with any other language, what does that mean? Same thing, different vibrational patterns on the ear nubs. So it becomes the old adage, a rose by any other name is still a rose. It's just a vehicle, not the object of connection. To me.
When I went to school, okay, my Spanish teacher.
At school back then?
There was a chisel and a hammer. But anyway, you know, this one teacher that said to me, she says, look, she says, you know, I was trying to decide, you know, like, you got to take a language when you go into college. You got to. I mean, it's part of your, I don't know, whatever. And she said, but you got to take Spanish. You should. She said, if you're going to go into sales or anything like that, you're going to bump into bilingual somewhere. So she said, take it. I said, okay, yeah, I'll take it. Now, I'm a brilliant person because I can read the back of a Mott's apple juice bottle.
You know? Excellent. Versatility, like knowledge.
Yeah, everybody in the place is saying, what's that say? Whoa, okay, last time I get you, baby. But, I mean, I'm serious. I mean, you know, all these things, you know, like you were talking about the people that were, you know, doing what they were doing. Like, I always see those people a sponge. When you're born as a baby, you are like a brand new sponge out of the cellophane.
And notice you can be born into any country, any language, any of those, and acquire the knowledge of it.
Anything you soak in from day one is going to sink. It's going to be there. It's going to be part of you. It's going to be in the DNA or in the brain or in the cells or whatever. These things, you know, I don't know. It just drives me crazy. Now, when people turn around and say, you know, all these people, they're doing this, they're doing that, they're doing the other thing. Hey, listen, you know what? I'll tell you something. We're all human beings. What we got to do is we have to start making sense to people. People believe that we believe that they are bad. If you're believed enough, just like with the news today, if you lie enough, people will
say something enough. They start to, yes, it only matters as long as it's in the news. Exactly. Once it's out, it's gone.
Exactly. Now, if you turn around and you tell people, hey, listen, man, you're really, really great. Let's do this. You know, we'll help you out a little bit. We'll put you in school now for a little bit. Put him in school, see how he's doing. Nurture a little bit, you know, checking how he's doing. Help him out a little bit more. It's like raising a kid, even though it's an adult.
Yeah.
Give him a little bit, a little bit, a little bit, a little bit, a little bit. If he turns back a little bit or something like that, kick him in the ass. You know, keep him going or her going forward all the time. All of a sudden, they turn around and say, well, you know what? I'm not going to kill or do drugs today. Those people turn into good people. I mean, people fertilize the land they live on.
A lot of times, yes.
By their attitude, by what they do, what they say, what they do for other people. Empathy is number one. I know that saying thank you is also number one, but you can say thank you for having empathy in the first place. I mean, I'm serious. That's what I don't see being taught. I don't know why, but I mean, look, I mean, no matter where I see it, people be, come on. I watched it on TV today. People are beating up a cop. Why beat up a cop? Because he's got a uniform on.
Yeah.
It's like, hey, you know, like you just turn around. It's a cop. I'll walk that way. And if you get arrested, he had to arrest you because you did something that wasn't nice.
Or illegal, possibly. Right. Yes.
We're all the same. But the idea of the thing is that people have to realize that, like, hey, whatever, I'm a product of what I am, i.e., I am. I am a product of everything around me. I interact with everything around me.
People around you.
Right. Exactly. We are all, we're walking universes.
You know, and I love to push buttons to go, what if, you know, that big bang that all of a sudden we were here? What if on a quantum level, you know, that was one of the choices in this case of humanity that created this whole entire universe? From the big bang and it keeps going. Really? What if it's a focused thought of expansion or something like that?
It's not a good idea.
Well, you know, that's why I'm like, oh, what if maybe just things are a little bit different than what we've been taught for all of these years?
Yes.
Again, the perpetuated pattern becomes the acclimation of empowerment.
Let me just interact for a couple seconds. If everybody out there that was watching Facebook today, you would have seen I put a little link on there. This is my chat room. I'm looking at it. If you read Facebook, you can chat with me all during these talks, and I don't see anything chatting on there.
Maybe we're amusing enough.
Maybe I have to text this message out to people. Maybe they'd see it better. The other thing is, there's also a text number that you can text to. So if everything boils down to kindergarten-based knowledge, text me at 863-222-4199. I'm also watching that. So all these screens are in my face. I can ask Jamie anything by reading it from your questions.
Yes. And this way, to help you to help yourself, guys, ladies and gentlemen.
Then we open up a dialogue between us. If you really, 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 really need help, you call in on 609-663-0153, and you can talk directly to Jamie live on the show. Is that a tough one? No. I mean, come on. The only thing I couldn't do is open up my back door and let you in. I mean, it's like, that's the only thing. That's the only thing I can do for, you know, further than that.
But, you know, it is a lot of comfort as a human in this case. Notice, on average, a lot of the ascended masters, most of the angels, look human. Mm-hmm. To me, scientifically, I'm not a doctor or scientist, but I always share the fact that I believe that they found that humans are basically energy, vibrational light beings. And with that definition of being energy in quantum physics, they found that energy can neither be created nor destroyed. But then I say, wait a minute, that means in a very scientific methodology that we are eternal and we've always been, and yet they perceive this universe has only been here 14.8 billion years. May not be from this universe. I'll guarantee you, as crazy as it is, we're not originally from this universe.
I could really, really give you one on there. Now, you said not from here. Okay. We know that right now, today, in our lives, there are a lot of doors opening up to the UFO theory, which is not a theory anymore. It's for real. Like, these people are from other places, and they're just checking us out. Let's face it.
Life is relative.
Right.
Because we as humans are extraterrestrials to everyone else.
Bingo. And if we go to the moon, what are we doing? We're checking out the moon. Is it hollow? I don't know if it's not hollow. Is there something in the back end? I don't know. But on the other side of that, all these people that are coming to Earth to check one thing. Maybe we were their creation through a higher universe, through the God. Maybe they were the pipeline that was God's original pipeline.
Or possibly a little what they've grown into through the humanity and experiences.
Yep.
Yes.
So if you take that into account, and we know already that from what we know from our own thoughts and things, the universe is billions and millions and quadrillion millions, you know, old. This has been around for a long time. And while it's been around now for so long, don't you think, or are you that decadent to believe that we're the only ones? No. As a matter of fact, what shows up here that we see on Earth, those little spaceships and everything else, and trust me, I mean, you know, I know from friends of mine, there are people on those things. The thing is this. If they're here to check us up, are we their ancients?
Yes.
Yeah.
What if, I mean, again, just my awareness, but I have a good friend who I haven't seen in years, but he used to work for the military. And back then he was in one of those silos where you turn the key and
Yep.
Well, there was a time that he was sharing where they had, I guess, cameras that could see out of, you know, the area there. There was a bright light that manifested right above. It shut. They were just sitting in a hole. They couldn't. I got us, just for me, the technological advancements that they have. What if they could do that for this entire planet? It's that easy. But yet they don't. So it becomes the comfort of familiarity, basically.
The theory that I had heard, now to you people that are listening, you can look this up because it's probably written somewhere, that if or when or the way you UFOs do hone in on us is by the signatures, the nuclear signature that we have in all these plants. They can actually literally you know, like see these things from wherever they are just because they're nuclear. I mean, let's face it, stuff goes out of silo. You know, there's got to be something somewhere.
Yeah.
But these are actually generators that are generating nuclear energy through fusion. And if you take all that and you put that all together, I'm sure that these guys can, you know, just zap in on you and say, whoop, that's a bad guy. They can also zap in on things that destroy, which it seems to them, nobody's ever been destroyed by a UFO. It's only on TV. Not for real. So they seem like the type of people that are babysitters to me.
And what if that is a little bit of the infancy of humanity? That some of these beings, yeah, you know, have the technology, because some of them are millions of years in advance of us as a human in this case. And what if they do have the technology to create moons and other ships and anti-gravity and molecular structures and, you know, all that kind of stuff? There's a very strong possibility.
Here's one for you. This will break you up a little. On planet Earth, now we were just talking about this before, about the Asians over there and, you know, the Germanics over there and the Norwegian people up there or whatever, you know, it's all over the place that we're different, or Africa with black people, whatever. Okay, why are they coming here? Is it because they want to see how all those races can live together? Because?
As we perceive it as humanity.
Right, because you have like ship one may have the praying mantises on them. Or, you know, the other ship may have another race on it. And the planet may be or be part of or be the race, the whole planet, one race. We, on the other hand, are the universal planet. We have it all. And all of it was apart from somewhere. So what did they do? Put a little piece of everything, you know, in here and everything. Like every single time you get one of these little meteors that come down, there's literally live material in those meteors.
I think because every time I see the moon, all I see is the craters that apparently meteors have hit. I don't believe that every single meteor goes straight on. Why are there no angled trajectory aspects? And it just for me in the moon's, you know, surface.
Whoever had the meteors was a good shot.
Yeah. Yeah.
They didn't miss.
But what if, you know, in this case, kind of like you're sharing, for me, my awareness is, I've in my own experience, that's all I can talk about, but there have been a number of, not just once, a number of times, experiences, circumstances in my life, going on 60 years now, in a way that I have connected with other species, other worlds of connection and communication. It is incredible, from the Nordics or the blondes as we perceive them, to the reptilians, to some others that I have made connections. And I can only speak for me, but I will tell you that those reptilians are shape shifters. Whatever the technology, whatever the ability that they have, they can literally change shape, form.
Yeah, well, if you talk to a buddy that we know that maybe on a show with us in that one of these days again, he will tell you that that is absolutely true.
No, yeah,
and yeah. One of them was sitting in Central Park on a bench.
You will feel, yes, I bet. You will feel the difference. Yes. I share the fact that for me, as when I was 10 years old is when I met the reptilians. I was up in Flagstaff. And in this, the things that I remember about this, one, I didn't know that they had families. As I'm going down this little dirt path, there's this other path that goes in front of me, and there's a little pond off to the side. And in the pond is what I saw is a boy and a girl, as I perceived it, reptilian. I'm like, I didn't even know they had freaking kids. And the things that I remember about this case, in this case, the male standing there, just standing there quietly, was the energy that vied from him in this case was like a human in the most maniacal rage. I'm like, how the frick is that possible? And the things that I remember about that being, one, the golden cat eyes. Two, perfect teeth, perfect. They weren't different sizes like us as humans. They were all the same size. And at least in this case, the male, perfect teeth. I don't know if they even have royalty, but for some reason, this, as we would perceive it, husband and wife or mother and father, or however we do that for, in this case, humans, it is amazing. It.
Hi there. How you doing there?
Ain't coming for you, boy. I will just say,
looking up,
they do have the tech. Some of them do have the technology to go interdimensional. What if this isn't the only dimension? What if there are many other dimensions besides the possible 11 that most people perceive? And again, I'm sure there's not more.
I was gonna say this is Florida, and the Cape is right over there.
Yeah, I bet.
I sent you the picture of the
yeah.
Yes. The rocket that went up. That was the trail of the thing. I mean, it's like, you know, we see those things and they're going off and it's like, oh no, man, another one. God dang.
And people get used to it. You see something enough, you're like, oh, that again. Okay. Yep. It becomes less, and on average, less connected to.
When I was up north, and then it was like, oh man, you know, go down. No, I took a tour, a whole tour of, you know, the Cape and things a couple of times. And it was like so cool, you know. And today it's like, okay, it's there. You know, it's like, hey.
I equate that like, yeah, like you're talking about that. People over in California are like, oh, yeah, the ocean. And us in Arizona like, oh, yeah, the cactus. And people are like, oh, my God. We're like, oh, we're used to it. And we see them everywhere. It's amazing what you get used to. Something that maybe others haven't experienced before. They're physically standing in front of you going, this is amazing. And we're looking at them going, it's just a cactus. Like, yeah, well, I've not seen one like that. I had no idea that they even existed.
Oh, yeah, they're like 30 foot tall, those things.
It's amazing. I used to have a saguaro cactus in my front yard, and you're not allowed, I don't believe, you're not legally allowed to cut things down or any of that. Uh-uh. And it's really interesting because for us, what the house that I used to have was the big saguaro cactus, and in that, a bird or birds had dug a couple of holes and it looked like a space. I'm like, oh my God, wow. That's freaking brilliant. And this is birds. I didn't see any humans coming around trying to chip on the cactus. Don't forget
those cactuses do store a lot of water. So if those birds are there digging holes, you know what they're doing? They're going in for a drink.
They're living. Yes, exactly.
They're not stupid. Humans are stupid. They could be in the middle of the desert somewhere, dying of thirst, see those things and go, oh, wow, it's another cactus. Not knowing a damn thing about it.
Well, and that's that, again, just there's that fine line between helping a planet and then causing and being the detriment. That's just for me. My awareness is our brothers and sisters are not going to come in and save us as a race, because if they did, that would be a beautiful intent. However, if they saved us as a race, and then because we're saved, we start going in other planets and other worlds, wait a minute, we're kind of starting to do that. That we'll start taking over that. Who do you think is going to feel bad? Well, we had the right intent. We wanted to help these people to help themselves. We just didn't realize they'd become planets, you know, that kind of thing. I'm sure none of that's there. They're not that stupid. They have an awareness of humanity and how we perceive things and the realities that we live in as we perceive it.
Coming back a little bit. When we talk about spirituality, seriously speaking, I mean, it's only because I know you for so many years and others. There are others and that I do know that are very much, you know, I'm a questioner. I will question, or like, well, I don't have to with our shows. I just played a show back. And I tell somebody half of the stuff that I get on, you know, when I do promos and everything else are from old shows. Because you're a big mouth. But anyway, it was, you know, some of the things that we had said, Ned, about spirituality, people take, I think, to a level that don't exist.
Give me an example. What do you mean?
Spirituality is something that you feel, that you practice, that you know. It's in you. We're all spiritual. Yeah, we're all
spiritual.
Right. We're all spiritual beings.
Yes.
Nothing that we're ever going to do to change that. We are what we are, period.
Except spiritual beings, in this case, having a human experience. So how do they do it on this planet, planet Earth? Well, you need a physical vehicle to get around. So whether it's a human, animal, or an insect, it is only a vehicle to house your soul print of consciousness. That's how we do it. You know, it's a dog's life going, oh, they are a lot of times a lot smarter than what you might even perceive.
Oh, come on. Now, you know this yourself, and from your dog and even from mine. Dogs sometimes are not doers. They'll just look at you.
They don't analyze. They feel it. Exactly.
They're thinking, man. They have a thing going. They're either going to bite your leg or not.
And a contributing factor why we love our fur babies, just one aspect, is they are great at reading energy. Because on average, we'll use them a gauge going, hey, they like you. All right, you must be okay. Or they don't like you. Something must be up. I'm very thankful and honored. I have a lot. I've got to do a lot of private sessions, and the families that are at the homes will a lot of times have a beautiful fur baby, and that dog in this case, or the cat, will just come right up to me, and they're like, "That they don't ever do that." I'm like, "Well, until now, so you can't say that." So it's playful, but this is the owners. I think you have an idea of who your fur baby is, and for them, you know, they're seeing Joe Schmo, meaning me, in their house that I don't believe I've ever been to before, nor have I seen that beautiful fur baby. And yet a lot of times if I'm sitting down, they'll come and lay right at my feet or right next to me or whatever the case is.
Do you also realize that many a time we are literally showing ourselves, we wear a picture of ourselves in energy all around our bodies. And these dogs, animals, period, any animal, can feel it.
They don't analyze it. They feel it. Yes,
exactly. And I only knew that for one. A quick story, very short. I went to someone's house that one time, and then I had to pick up something. And I went to the house, and like any idiot like me would probably do, is you just open up the gate and you go into the yard, not knowing that the pit bull that was around the corner.
God.
Was a guard dog. I mean, the kind that didn't think, just bit. That's how he was raised. That's how he was supposed to be. And, you know, because he had a whole bunch of stuff that was very valuable down in the house. And no drugs or anything. But, I mean, it was like this guy had anything from gold to a whole bunch of stuff in coins and all kinds of stuff. I was picking up some to go back to his shop with. Anyway, the dog runs up to me. Puts on the brakes, you know, two front legs and they come out and he puts on the brakes and he just looks at me. And the guy, and I'm looking at the dog and he's looking at me, right? So I put out my hand and I said, here, you want a whiff? Go ahead, take a whiff. And the guy, meanwhile, unbeknownst to me, is right behind the door, the glass door that was there, watching what was going on with his heart in his mouth. He didn't want to say anything because of what I was doing. Okay, I do the thing. I pet the dog underneath the chin and everything else. I said, man, you're awesome. Take off. And he did. And then I walked back to the house. And the guy said, man, I was really hoping you passed to pay up your insurance. He said, that dog, he said, where you were, he said, if he even saw me or even knew I was around, he said, would have killed you in seconds. In seconds. He said, you would have lost your neck. He said he's that big. I mean, he was big enough that he could jump up 6 foot if he had to.
Yeah.
And I said to the guy, I said, look, I said, first of all, I didn't know anything about the dogs. The third of all, I says, I go up to every dog and do that, and they all do the same thing. So I said, what's the big deal? So the guy said, I don't know. He said, put Saint in front of your name next time.
But look, that's when it gets real, because they're like, they don't do that. And you're like, oh, really? Oh, okay. Well, apparently they do.
I'll give you another one, you know, for people that are listening to this right now. If you go to adopt a dog, just walk slowly and just look at the dogs that are in the place. If you want to, just put your hand down and let it pass the chain link on the thing. Take the dog home that doesn't do anything and just looks at you. Not the ones that are jumping all over the place. Just the one that's just sitting there looking at you. And sit down, you know, like not sit down on the ground or anything else, but crouch down a little bit and say, do you want to go home with me? And I said, the dog will react then, because they say that dog wants you. whether you want him or not, that's another story. But
yeah,
want you. Two dogs we had as rescues that are here, even Kit that's here now. And that I did that too. And these dogs are the best dogs we ever had. Jake was unbelievable. You know, Jake was an unbelievable dog. Bijou was another one. And this one is Kit. And all three of them are like, they're lovers. That's it, period. End of story. And all three of them were just the dummies that just sat there and went, okay, you're taking me home, right? Yeah, right? Right now? Later? Oh.
Yeah.
That's the ones that you got to get, because the ones that are jumping all over the place, Ned, they haven't calmed down yet to know that there is an end to their agony. The other ones say, I've had enough, let's go.
And that's a big thing. And I share the fact that when we got our fur baby, Simba, who's amazing, I was sure the fact that he has every amazing quality. I could literally put a stake down in front of him. He won't even look at it until I say it's okay. And I never had to hit him, nothing, ever, ever. And right, when we right. first met him, he was at a pound, and he was off the euthanasia list, and he was at this place for about 6 months on the outside.
Ow.
Well, yeah, we were looking, and we had a beautiful fur baby named Coda who graduated life. And so I asked him in this case, you know, hey, can you help us find a dog that's similar to you that maybe has some of those qualities? Because you're amazing. He was like, well, yeah. And then we had some of the angels, the channel, the angels, moving from to when we found Simba and now having him home, he has about 90% of the qualities and characteristics that Coda had.
Right,
it's
right.
freaking brilliant. Yep. And that's something just like that is I do not chance it, because when we first got him, and I was amazed that I didn't get it, but he was very loving with Maggie and I, very loving, not even a question. Well, we had some friends come over, and one of the friends was sitting down because they hadn't met him yet. And he's just like, da, la, 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 you know, just lightly goes over and gets up on the couch. And as soon as, thankfully, God, Maggie had his collar and pulled him away. I was like, I didn't even catch that. He went from la, la, la to instant. So yep. just for me, when we take him out for walks, which is every morning and a lot of times in the evening as well, is if we see somebody on the sidewalk, we'll literally cross the street.
All right. Right.
Yeah, I will not chance that at all. For anybody, that's dynamic.
You have to remember, he's guarding the property, his property, and that's exactly what they do. And you know, if anybody has any, I know a bunch of people have been sending me more stuff about dogs. I mean, and I appreciate it. Like, you have no idea. Thank you. I read everything you send. I get it on the messenger. I get it on Facebook. I get it on my mail email. Send more. Doesn't matter. I read it all. And I love the kind of stuff in it. I've seen dogs that were anything from abused to just about dead to winning awards. Now, people send me some really, really crazy things. Well, to go back to another thing that we were talking about, dogs and their feelings. Every once in a while, when I'm right here and I'm on the radio, before Jake had his graduation and he went ahead, he used to sleep right down, if you remember, he used to sleep right down.
Right at your feet, yep.
Right at my feet. And when he got up, of course, he'd have to rub and, you know, do his little rub thing and everything and that, and then, you know, take off to wherever he was going. I've felt it so many times while I'm on the radio. He's still around.
Yep. Now,
where is he? I'll tell you where he is. Right here in the heart. The heart and the body and the mind and the what we are, the energy that's in us, store all those times that he rubbed my leg. And all of a sudden, the body itself, the physical, the actual carbon body, turns around and says, oh, I felt that.
What if that's part of the magic? What if that's why I share for myself and the scientific studies that I do. If you are doing psychic or mediumship, you are picking up on other people's thought patterns. Mm-hmm. And I share the fact that I'm not a doctor or scientist, but there's a gentleman who was known, he graduated life, but he was known as Dr. Masaru Emoto, and he did hidden messages in water. And he was a scientist who wanted to see if the molecular structure of water holds thought patterns thought within it. And each and every time he did this, he got the same results. And they always have pictures. I always share people, please check it out. That way he moves from, oh, okay, to, oh, okay. Mm-hmm. And so what he did, basically paraphrasing, is take two separate containers of water, and he had one group send one container positive, loving, happy thoughts and froze it. The other container, negative, challenging, bad thoughts and froze it. Each and every time he took those ice crystals out, sliced them up and put them under an electron microscope, he saw that the molecular structure of the water that was sent negative and challenging thoughts was gross and murky. And again, they have pictures. And then it flips over to the light energy that was sent positive is like snowflakes and prisms.
Right.
I'm like, wow, that's impressive and powerful in a scientific methodology. And I share the fact that I believe that there are a couple of things that are almost 70% water on the planet, and the oceans in the human body. Yeah, you know, something like that. And well, so
You can talk to plants too.
Yeah, oh, they are, that stuff is real.
Every time I talk to, like we had down here in Florida, I mean, it was absolutely terrible. I mean, I put up when I was in New Jersey, if I put up a garden, a real garden, vegetable garden, I'd have like, I don't know, maybe 8-10 tomato plants as tall as me.
Wow.
6 foot tall, wide, you know, big tomatoes and everything else. Down here in Florida, the sun is so bright and so energy full, it actually toasts these things. I mean, you have to constantly water all the time.
Notice the same plants, but in different areas, you have to treat them differently.
Exactly. But the thing is that every time when I planted them this spring and that, I walked by this one tomato plant and he gave me the leave. He went. I went by. I said, what's the matter with you? Come on. Why don't you want to grow with me?
It is amazing.
Yeah, they're so cool.
Well, and a number of years ago, I had a person that I was connected with, and it was Christmas time, and I used to get the live trees and put them in, and they were beautiful because I love the liveness type of thing. Well, there was a time I'm just sitting there, and all of a sudden, mindsight, I have no idea except that it was like a ball of light went from my tree to the other person's tree and back to me, that tree going, they're not using purified water. Because my friend, I'd let him know, please use purified water. It helps, and you know, a little bit less chemicals than that. And then I called this person and they were like, no, I'm not putting that. I'm like, holy crap. That was, of course, a metaphysical experience of the physical reaction to go, in this case, this person wasn't putting the purified water. And how the frick are these trees in this case that are already cut? They were cut from the earth as we perceive it. And in this case, they were in, you know, containers of water to keep them going. Right. My thing is I have no idea why it was a ball of light, but went beep and went over to the other one and back to me. It was amazing. And then to get the validation, talking with my friend that they weren't using that, I'm like, that's impressive. There is consciousness. This planet is consciousness. The planets, the stones, the rocks, all that kind of stuff. Moves from the airy fairy to, okay, scientific methodology. All right, maybe there's something to this. There's spiritual stuff.
That's another reason why I want people to call in, and especially when we do the other show. It's got to be a show that people always call into. It's got to be one. I don't want to see the same people all the time. I want to see. I mean, come on, man. There's like millions of people in America and all over the world, by the way, because we're using Skype. I mean, I've talked to Africa. I don't know how many times. I mean, the white lion. What do they call that? It's where they keep them in Africa, and you know, a few other places. I've talked to Egypt. I've talked to Norway. I've talked to Ireland. I've talked to Russia. Russia was kind of funny because the only way we could do things was for the show was to text back and forth, and then I had to read out the thing that they had because they can't, you know, they have when you see ru.com, you know there's something going on, but you know, and these are university kids, and they're not used to on their radio, they're not used to people talking like we do. You know, that's the freedom that we have here that they don't have there. I mean, they're more regimented. It's you don't have to, you know, if you're going to talk about this, you talk about this. And if you only talk about the subject, you don't go out of the lines or anything. So who knows? You know, it's going to be one of those crazy things.
Well, and that kind of brings up an interesting dynamic for myself, and that is linear time. To me, there is no linear time. I'm like, really, daylight savings, is it really? And then I share the fact that, right, if I'm on the internet, which I do quite a bit, I do public presentations, and I'll have a lot of times someone calling from Australia, which is about 17 hours ahead of us or in the future as we perceive it, or sometimes from the Hawaiian Islands, which is on average a couple of hours in our past or behind us. Yet when we're connecting on the internet web, kind of like the universal web, the past, present, and future are all now.
All now.
It's all experienced in the moment.
Yep.
That's cool.
That's, you know, there's a bunch of people too in that also write me from London. Like, they may be listening to this right now. The thing is, they can't call me on the phone. You know, and we didn't put it on Skype, which I will. You know, you put the meetup thing in that, and anybody from anywhere in the whole world can Skype in if they want to. And they always say that the shows are refreshing, they say. Of course, you know the BBC stuff. I mean, it's all, they got their nose up. Oh, well, you know, I'm going to, I mean, come on. Give me a break.
What was that
say? It's like, why don't somebody, look, for instance, say somebody burned down a house. They would go into this long thing and about, well, you know, the guy, he was this and that, and it's, you know, three generations back in his family, they did whatever, and they go on and on and on. Instead of somebody saying, why the hell did the guy burn down the house, damn it? I mean, it's, you know, it's like, that's what we do, you know, because that's just the way we are. But you see, that's the soul talking, and people don't get this. We got a soul inside of us. I'm like the, what was that rabbit with the battery in the back?
Oh, the Energizer Bunny.
We are Energizer Bunnies. That's what we are. The soul is the battery.
And what if that battery has this body around it and it's completely the other way? Because most people perceive you're in the human body with a soul. What if this is just a reflection of consciousness to go in this case? Like I said, that's how they do it on this planet. You need a vehicle to get around. Because if you're starting to hear voices, oh, you're crazy. And I always share the fact that there is a fine line between what we do in the nut house. There are some sane people. They just don't understand what's going on. I'm hearing voices. I'm like, man, I hear it all day long. And people seek me out. They don't fear me. It's, if it scares you, it's going to freak them out.
The thing that makes this motor, this body work, is the energy that comes from around us, the universe that powers us. The outside of us is, as I said, like the Energizer Bunny. It's something that you could throw in the garbage and who cares? Because the actual soul is you. You are the soul, the energy that powers you to speak, hear, see, et cetera, et cetera. All those things are powered by the battery, which is there, or the soul. And that soul is, you know, how would you say it? Your spirit, your spiritual attachment to the universe. And, you know, as many times I try to explain that to somebody, it's like, really? Yeah? Where do I plug in? I was like, douche. You know, drives me crazy. But you know, we walk around, like, I told this one guy, you got to do what I do. Because when I get up at like 3 o'clock, 3:30 in the morning, and then I take the dog out for a walk and things. I am out. There's nothing going on. There's no sound. There's all the stars and everything else that up in the air. I can think about anything I want to, and I'll answer. A lot of times I get an answer.
And notice you're sitting here. You're just talking about it, yet you're vibing with the experience as if it's going on now.
Right. Exactly. I can see in my mind. I can see, like, the one time, I think this is a long, long time ago. If you remember the first time that we were down in Charleston, and we're talking like 10 years ago.
Yeah. A little bit more. Yeah.
As I walk with the dog, and that thinking away like usual in that hour in the morning, like my walking, I call it walking meditation. The trees, they had these Chemlec trees with these huge weed, like leaves like this. I mean, they were like 10 inches across or something. And it was a whole tree of these things. And it was a whole line of those trees down the street. And as we walked, the leaves turned on the trees. I thought you could hear it happen. And I thought I was like, you know, crazy, right? So I turned around and holy shit, you know, what the? And you could see that as you walk down, you could see the green front of the leaves. When I was down the block already and I turned around, I could still see the fronts of the leaves.
What? So,
very weird.
Yeah, but what if some of that, because that's a dynamic that I learned when we were out walking in the desert over here in Arizona, and that is that the plants do have consciousness. What if some of the more highly advanced beings in this case are able to tap into those frequencies, in this case of the plant life, and literally use it like a speaker for them to hear?
You mean Biden?
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, you said plant energy, so.
Yeah, it's interesting, but yeah. And that's like, just for me, once I had that experience, I'm like, I have no choice but to go, I don't understand it. I just experienced it. Firsthand, not secondhand. I always say secondhand is lovely. Firsthand is solid.
I think you might also remember in that. I have every once in a while, that I have a guy on that's a plant man. He's a tree man. He plants trees all over the United States.
Cool.
And a nursery man and everything else. When I told him that story, he says, don't you know? He said, that happens all the time. I was like, oh. And this is a guy that deals with plants all the time. So, I mean, you know, it wasn't that crazy. But people walk around and believe that what they do or the life that they are born into is what is going on in their life right now. And it's not. There's so much more that's going on.
So we either perpetuate patterns or we change them.
And there could be more. There can be more. And like everybody says, gee, you know, I wish I was doing that. Don't wish. Do it.
Do, yes.
Do it. And if you get, all right, say for some reason or another somebody can't afford to do something. How do you get to that point? You work to that point. You have to get the fuel for the energy to make the energy work to get to that point. So go make some money. That's the gas. Put it in the motor. That's the jet engine.
Yeah.
Turn on the jet engine with your mind saying, I can do that.
And where do you want to captain that to go?
And do it.
That's the thing. It just takes some guts to be able to get up in the air, so to speak, and see things from a different vantage point. It's easy. Sometimes it can be very scary for people. But
that goes back to I am.
Yep. Not I was, not I will be. I am.
I am in the moment.
It's what we're talking about. There's only the eternal moment. No. That's why in that quantum field, all from my awareness is, and what she shared with me, my master guide, is that on that quantum level, all experiences are happening now. All potential outcomes are happening now. My soul print in each one of us is connected to each and every one of those alternate realities and outcomes. And just because you're not aware of it does not mean it's not being registered into your Solidex or Akashic Records, whatever you want to label it, as an eternal soul print of consciousness. Because just for myself, I've seen a lot of the past life regressions, which is beautiful, but they tend to only stay on this planet. I'm like, we go way beyond this. What about all the other lifetimes, all the other dimensions and worlds and universes you've been in? Just something to think about, because it just takes that seed of consciousness. First is the thought, then the creation.
There was a person that was on one time, and it does hypnotism and regressions and things. He does this. And he told me that some of the people do go to other places.
Excellent. Yes.
The places.
If they're ready for it.
No. They don't know. They don't know where it is. They say it's cold. It's warm. It's this. It's that. It's war rocks. It's this. One of the persons actually described what the people look like and everything. What people in it around him look. In fact, he thought he looked like those other people at the time. in his dream. So, I mean, let's face it, our minds, I don't know, you know, really, I mean, I know this is true, but I mean, to say something like this, they're going to say, oh, you're doing, you're telling us a lie, or your conspiracy is all over the country.
That job, yeah.
Yeah, exactly. But we are actually getting dumbed down. It's up to us to keep ourselves on that other level, the regular level, the whole thing. And all that crud that we're fed left and right, I'm telling you, I mean, like, look, you got to think about the I am and use that for yourself. You are your own software. So, okay.
Why do you say software?
Huh?
Why did you say software?
I say software in that because your mind is built.
What if it is like a computer?
In parts, like a computer. You know, the reason why that is because every piece of information, if you know a lot about computers, every single piece that comes in is a packet of information. It's a little chip of information, like this place, that thing, what I did, what I'm doing right now, what I'm going to do when I'm all done, going to sleep, getting up tomorrow morning. Every single one of those experiences are a little piece that goes into the computer brain. Into a cell. Each one of those cells could also be a SIM card. If you know what a SIM card is, basically it's the same thing. It takes all that memory, puts it in one place. Someday you're going to want to go back and go want to check on that information. You want to check back in your memory. Like I've said to you a couple times, I remember me when I was like 2 riding on the back and my mother pulling me around on a vacuum. Now, how did I get from here to 1952? I mean, that's a long ride, man, because somewhere, somehow, it was put together and saved. And if we know, if we realize that it was saved, it will stay. Otherwise, it could go into the archive file or
delete
it.
Which usually does. Yep.
Delete it. And it's there. And then you'll stand on your head a million times, and then finally somebody will say, oh, you mean when? And you'll go, oh, yeah. You know, I mean, I'm serious. It happens.
It does a lot. And that's why it becomes the challenge of awareness is a lot of people don't want to be seen as one of them. They're nut jobs and crazies. And I'm like, one, be skeptical about everything. Question everything. Just be open. That's why I love doing the scientific methodologies and what we're doing scientifically, categorizing, systematizing, repeated. You know, maybe there's something to this spiritual stuff. Is that what they call it? I'm like, yeah, whatever you want to call it. It's just a label.
You know what?
Nothing, 0 point field, whatever you want to call it.
You know what I'm seeing right now? What just passed through my mind? You and I sitting at one table in a diner talking just like we are right now.
Yeah.
In a place coming to stand to see what we're saying.
I love it. Yes.
I saw that picture. That was pretty funny. And the person that was there was the waitress.
And notice how we're sitting here in this dimension, yet you're instantly on that other dimensional experience, like, oh, that's weird, it just kind of dropped in. Really? Yeah. What if we're just becoming conscious of the information that's always playing? Just and sometimes it's, I didn't think of it that way. I'm like, oh, well, you know, just something to think about. And when they can realize that, one, I always say, the more I know, I don't know nothing, man, but I'll share my perspective.
I also had the best sausages I've ever had. I don't know why.
Beautiful. But I what if that in. Symbolically and literally can nourish their soul?
Yeah. Yeah, well, there you go. There you go.
You know, and again, it's the premise of what we like or don't like. Remember, that with which is in harmony with what we're wanting is good. That which isn't is bad. Mm-hmm. It's a very relative term.
We got to do this again. But the next time that we do this and that, what I want to do, since I only got, you know, one in on the phone, and it's been all over everything. It was in Twitter. It was on Facebook.
You do a fantastic job. Thank you for everything you do, Bob.
It was all over the place. Now, what I'm going to get is you're going to get a bunch of stuff on here that's going to say, oh, can I have a copy of that show? Why? Why?
That's the convenience.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, it's, you know, they can listen to it. What I tell people that all the time, because my people at work do it, you know, they'll take a show and they'll stick it on their phone. They got their earbuds in. They can work all day long and listen to the shows.
Yeah, huh? No, not distracted.
The funny part is when you and I are on a show, or maybe one of my other shows, it depends upon how the archive plays it, but it's one of these things that where you see somebody laughing walking around. You want to know, what show are you on?
You know? Yeah, what are you laughing about? What brings you happiness? Exactly. Just people need to know, oh, it's possible to be happy. And there can be many different reasons why that end result would be happiness. I'm like, brilliant.
The funny part is when somebody asked me a question about a show that I did 10 years ago. Okay, yeah.
I bet you remember a lot of them, too. I'm like, wow.
Sometimes it depends upon how they ask the question, but, you know, it's like, hey.
What if you are a go-to person? What if it's a little bit easier and more positive that they don't have to be distracted and sit down? What if they can plug those earphones in and listen to it without having to stop? They just add it as a part, a layer of experience and add it on flavor kind of thing.
I always tell people, look, life is something that we only go around once. Then we can come back and go again. And again, and again, and again, and again, and again, and again, and again. Okay, so you can take all these things, you know, and say, okay, I'm crazy. That can't happen. Okay, well, you know, let's face it. This is the way it goes around. That soul, you know, has the chance. I was over there on the other side, and I can tell you that I was told I didn't belong there, and pow, I wake up in a hospital.
But don't you find that interesting? I always share the fact that there are a lot of, I call it a near life experience because to me there is no death. But I'm like, well, don't you find that interesting? Because there are a lot of people who I will talk with who's had an NDE, a near death experience. And they'll have a loved one going in, it's not your time. And they get pushed back. Well, don't you find that interesting? Someone else knows your time frame of existence. Isn't that kind of weird?
Well, no, wait a minute. A lot of those people that do meet or don't see the entity that's talking to them or the voice or whatever, they don't. But when I was there, I met my father. My father was there. When I came back, when I was in one piece anyway, it was, I talked to, I think it was an aunt or something, and I told her about, you know, what he had. Like, he had his union buttons on hat and the gray thing and, his uniform because he was a truck driver, you know, and I saw the whole thing. And he passed away on the truck. On the truck. He had a massive heart attack and passed away on the truck. And I saw him like I remembered seeing him all the time. Because sometimes we'd have, I was a kid, but we used to have coffee in the morning. He used to go like 5 o'clock in the morning. And he would be, you know, driving down to where the trucks were. And he'd, you know, get his little bit of breakfast or whatever else he was going to get. And then he'd, you know, go. And a lot of times that I come downstairs and say, hey, can I have some coffee here? Yeah, one of those things. And he used to make me up a little cup and everything else in it so we could sit down. He'd eat his breakfast and I'd have my coffee. But I remembered the uniform my whole life being part of him.
Look at so how you just talked about it, yet that physical connection is there. I saw it, and I saw these feet, you know, and the hat, and more than likely the loved ones still here were like, as a matter of fact. And you're like, oh, well, I had no idea, but that's what I saw.
But that's why I always tell people that whoever you know, you love, you pair with, I mean like, you know, not more than best friends. One of those kind of pairs. The sure. one that asked, you know, yep. One of those things. I said, you're going to see that person again. Probably now. And they're looking at me like, huh? I said, yeah. I said, if he chooses to, he can, like.
Oh, they're very talented at that. Yes.
Yeah. And they go, hey, like, you know, I'm here. Like, you know, you either you could do this, you could do that or whatever else. They're like guardian angels in a sense. Not that we don't have one. But sometimes, you know, they get a little pushy and they want to know something. I'm sure that my father's looking at me somewhere and they say, oh, I can't wait till you get up here.
You've already been up there.
No. I mean, on a more permanent level.
But notice, more than likely, when you had that experience where you saw Dad and the hat and all of those, it was physical. Just as solid as this third dimension is physical. It's like, really? Is it? What if it's all energy?
That's what you feel. You know, but a lot of people that do see the tree in the field.
And yeah. Yep.
I or did. It was the like the field. The what do they call it? Things. The tree of life, in the middle of this big green tree. Wow. And now I've been told, because I always grow such beautiful lawns and everything else, and that's why I sow the lawn, you know, and everything. No. When I came into wherever it was, that's where I was. And everybody keeps saying, I saw lights, I went through the tunnel and all this kind of stuff. I know a lot of people do. But in a blink of an eye, I was standing on grass. I went from one real reality to another. I don't remember.
Exactly.
I don't remember anything in between. I don't remember lights. I don't remember tunnels. I don't remember anything. All I know is I was here and then I was there. And there was a picture. The state police anyway had a picture of me actually laying on a black bag.
Wow.
So, I mean, like, hey, see if, you know, one of those things.
Yeah.
A little surprised too. I started breathing and like that was a whole another wall, you know, ball game. And I'm still here. And for some reason, maybe somebody's punishing me and leaving me here. But
what if you're just doing it for yourself?
Yeah. Yeah. On the other hand, he did say before I left that the children needed me. Now, children, I looked that up, man, all over the place. And everything from God, you name the religion, I was in it. Children are us. They are the masters. We are the children.
And a lot of times that's why they're considered ascended masters. They transcend this third dimensional reality as we perceive it.
Exactly. So therefore, what we do, what we speak, what we talk, things that we try to teach people, things that we present to people, all of this stuff is part of our job. You know, it doesn't feel like a job. I mean, let's face it, I can, you know, go outside there and say, hey, man, how you doing? You know, hey, wow. All that crazy stuff, you know, but I mean, all these things are not, it's not a job. It's us helping someone. It doesn't matter whether it is or it isn't. Like if, for instance, like let's go back to what I was just making fun of. If you saw a pretty girl and you turn around to the girl and say, you are beautiful. And I've done it. I have done it. That person that might have been feeling she was not herself or the beautiful woman or anything else. She's now the top of that pile, and she is number one to herself.
And you didn't go into a trance. You lived your own life, doing your own thing, perceiving it the way you do, and you were lined up. That's that precision, not luck or coincidence. In the beginning, it seems like luck and coincidence, unlike there is none. But if it's precision on the universe's part.
But without people even knowing these things are happening, they are happening. They're happening every day to all of us.
Yes. And every moment, every choice, creating sometimes a whole new universe or life experience or dimension or whatever the case is. And again,
as I've said at the end of our shows before, we are so cool.
I love it. And when we can have great conversations and we're just being us, that's all we can be. And always be genuine. As I always say, always be humble. We are no better or no worse. Just do you.
Hey, Jason, are you back?
Yes, I am.
Yes, you are. Did you want to talk to Jamie?
Yes, I did.
Yes, you do. Well, go ahead, Jamie.
Jason, what's going on? How can we be of service?
Well, how are you? Do you need my birthday to tell me what's going on?
I'm sorry. I heard a birthday, I think.
Okay, do you need my birthday?
No, sir. No, I just have your soul print energy. Thank you, though. That's a lot of people notice there's many different ways to read energy. So, yeah, do you have a question? Anything that we can share some insight?
Yes. Okay. Since I'm supposed to be a Gemini, why is it that I have had very few romantic avenues in my life?
What if in this case, one of your choices was to find more of yourself within life and less of losing yourself to it? And in doing that, because you vibe very spiritually aware in your own way as well. So it's like, no, to me, everything is spiritual and we're all interconnected. But in addition,
okay.
the individual empowerment to go, it's always a beautiful dynamic to have someone in our life experience to maybe share things with. However, if we don't, who are we going to share it with? Ourselves. 100% a person and complete. To me, it's not 50-50 and they're never complete, the only compliment. It's that kind of connection that I feel like. The good thing is you're not just, oh, somebody acknowledged me. Oh, it's got to be. It's like, no, always be nice, of course. But when we can have people who may not know us, and in this case, if it's the opposite sex or whatever it is that has an appreciation, like Bob and I were saying, sometimes, hey, you know, you may not be having a great day or you're down in whatever avenue. And then Bob, in his own way, he wasn't made to, he was allowed to, came in. And in this case, he was able to share that that lovely young woman who may not have been in the best mood, all you had to do was turn around and acknowledge that beauty. And all of a sudden, now it became real. What if, just in this case, Jason, you are the independent person who is going to be able to know they're 100% a person and complete, and that they can come in and co-create these relationships in whatever way, whatever you would like to. Because I do feel like, even though if you're with someone, I'm sure it's amazing, but I also feel like you're going to be opening the door to other friendships, other opportunities of a relationship, if you even choose to go that direction.
Also, it seems like when I'm older, it seems like the younger people, I'm attracted to the younger people most of it. And then when I was 25 or so, the older ones would try to hit on me. I guess it's just like reverse energy or something.
Well, yeah, exactly. To me, it is. It's all energy. And look at the connection. Hey, in one aspect, you're appreciating that connection. And the other one, people are like, okay. And you're like, it's all, what if, I always say cosmically, we are all the same age. Cosmically, we are all one.
I thought so. But you know, nowadays, it's hard to find quality people because what gender they might be. Because sometimes we can be more intelligent because they say, you know, Gemini, we're sort of a very wise, we think and we compile things and we, you know, some people think because we may be quiet, but the other half can show them that we're not that docile as they may think.
And so what do? Live our reality as we perceive it the best that we can. For me, if I can help someone to help themselves, I will do it. I'm about empowerment, not enablement. Because to me, you know, as I always say, I'm not a doctor or a scientist, but as we perceive that, that enablement is, I want to do the best I can to understand where that person is at, kind of what channel they're tuning into, so that I can communicate and talk with them, not just to them. Because most of us are used to being talked to rather than talked with. And you've got this soul searching energy going on in a beautiful way, Jason, which is great.
Well, thank you. Okay.
Yeah, and you're just being you. The good thing is it's not what you want to hear, it's what you need to hear. That's why, you know, I will not make stuff up. If I hear, you know, I always say I could certainly be wrong, but I'm usually pretty good. It's that kind of connection that there are a lot of times. That's why I always say there's a lot of responsibility that goes with what we do as a psychic medium. Because the more accurate you are, the more responsibility goes with it. I share the fact that there are a lot of times when I have someone new who I haven't seen before come to me for a session, and I'll give them a potential upcoming psychic read, and they'll be like, yeah, sure, whatever. And I'm like, no, I could certainly be wrong, but, you know, I guess we'll see. They usually come back going, what else you got to say? Because I thought you were full of crap and all that stuff happened. Now, as I shared, for that person, anything and everything coming out my mouth is the gospel to that person, because they thought all that other stuff was a bunch of crap and then it happened. What they're not tuning into is the quantum level of life experience and co-create. To me, what we think about and what we focus on from that quantum level, because as a psychic, all we are is a quantum road sign. If you take this direction, this experience is most likely the outcome. If you take this one, here's most likely the outcome. And usually I'm pretty accurate. And the great thing is, I always say, if I'm good, you're great. All I'm doing is reading your energy of thought patterns of consciousness, the seeds of consciousness, basically.
Okay. Many people don't understand me. Is that true?
They don't understand you or what?
I guess they don't understand because I'm older. You probably can always tell how old I am psychically.
Well,
but sometimes they don't. I guess because I'm intelligent and I don't. I'm not. Crazy over frivolous things.
So,
and
you're going to attract more people that can hang on that channel of what you're tuned into, that intelligence. And a good thing is, I always say, there's as many worlds as there are perceivers. Nobody sees it the same, yet each just as real and just as valid. And a good thing is apparently you do have a few years of wisdom and life experience in this case, but I'm like, wow, you sound pretty youthful. So the good thing is that voice, that vibrational energy.
You know, Jason, okay. Jason, this is Bob.
Yeah.
All right. What I was going to say to you is if I'm talking the way I am and you know, about the experiences and the whole nine yards, I'm 73. And
well, you know how old I am?
I don't.
Should I tell you?
Should
I tell you how old I am?
61?
Yeah, please. Let's give the people a reference.
Yeah, now.
You can tell us. Go ahead.
76.
Okay, so you got me by 3 years. Big deal.
Fantastic.
You know, you know what? I'll tell you something. At our ages, right, do you feel 76? No. Do I feel like 73?
No.
No. Can I go out and play tennis?
No.
Still, yes.
I could do something.
Yeah. So, I mean, let's face it, man. We are so cool. Quote unquote myself.
Just do you? Yes.
You know, let's face it.
Sometimes we okay. How about dating? How about getting to know somebody that's in their 20s or 30s? That would be too young for us.
I would think, you know, let's face it. You know, they're not old enough to realize what love is.
A lot of times.
They don't. It may just be a simple gratification, but it's supposed to be more than that.
That's it. Yeah, it's a gratification. That's about the size. But now the ones that are older. Now you're talking like over the 45 mark. You know what I'm saying?
Now that's okay. We can deal with them because they're more mature and they got wisdom and understanding.
Bingo! You got it right. That was it. Bingo. You know what I mean? It's like, hey, listen. You know what I mean? If you're gonna play a game of that in a casino or something like that, you better have played it 100 times if you want to win.
That's right. And then you have wisdom and understanding. They say, oh, this is new. I said, well, that's okay. We've done it several times, so let me show you what you have to do.
Bam.
I've had many footsteps in my...
I'm sorry. I was flapping my gums. I apologize. What did you say, Jason?
No, that's okay. But anyway, I was just saying that I've had many footsteps in my life. You know, when I mean footsteps, I mean a lot of people have been very close to me and I got a chance to love them or whatnot, just like friends or whatnot, and they passed on. And I still miss them because that's, like I say, it's hard to find quality people nowadays.
Right. But notice, as soon as you're thinking of your loved ones, whomever they might be that graduated, they're right here, right now. It is that direct interaction and connection that we always have, to me, as it is all truly one. It is amazing.
You know, can I add something to that on the dating side? Okay.
Okay.
Jason, listen to me very carefully. Number one.
Okay.
What you're saying is something that I used to say, but then forgot about a long time ago, is saying like, it's my age. Am I going to meet quality people? Is that person going to be around? Am I going to be able to love someone else? Am I going to be, you know, there's a million different questions that you could use. The thing is this, we are what we are. You know what I mean? It's one of these things where love is going to come to you. You're not going to go to love. You don't. Let's face it. We're not fishing. We're not throwing.
In other words, don't go looking. Let them come looking for us.
No, just look. You can still look.
Okay.
But not really, really look. You know what I mean? It's your energy that they're going to be attracted to. The one that's attracted to your energy. Or whom you are and what you are, those people are the keepers. The rest of them, let's face it, it's like going fishing, throw them back.
And so if you're interested, Jason, to create kind of a new dynamic, if you're open, don't say anything to anyone, but I would love for you to at least 1 minute a day, if you're okay with that, I want you to just sit down and feel these great people in your life experience. Great conversations, excellent trust, love, compassion, empowerment, whatever the qualities are, and then just be open. Let the universe, through co-creation, not manipulation, bring you more of the people, circumstances, and experiences matching more of what you're thinking about in that thought process.
That's
because you know, it's a great dynamic. And you, again, sound pretty youthful. 76, you're like my really, really, really old brother.
You know, Gemini, they said we don't age, although we get older, we don't age, but I guess because there's a twin. You know, one twin can be sort of quiet and one twin can be a little bit crazy at times.
Yeah.
And that's why Gemini don't age quick.
You know, Jason, I'm a Taurus. And a Taurus is a love machine. And guess what?
You're loyal. Sometimes you can be very dynamic, and sometimes you're very loyal, and sometimes you can be very forceful.
Oh yeah.
And you don't take much junk. And you don't take much junk with me. I have to think about it and wonder, you know. But see, a Taurus would protect a Gemini always.
Oh yeah.
Just like a Leo. Just like a Leo and a Scorpio,
yep.
They say, I know you didn't fool around the crazy mess, so look, what's the problem? I'm with you.
There you go.
And what if, just in a potential dynamic, because I always question things, but I have seen a lot of people through the astrology that if you have that particular sign, a lot of times you'll have a lot of those qualities and characteristics. What if just in one, just one contributing factor is we choose our incarnations on this planet by the stars, literally.
Okay.
That connection. That's right. So, you know, just something to think about. Okay.
We're getting ready to get out of here. We're already on a lot of overtime.
Well, thank you.
Jason, wait, don't go anywhere. Where did you find out this number?
It was on the internet about an hour ago. I'm calling from the Atlanta area.
Okay.
And I happened to see on the internet, and I made a note to decide to get a reading from them. But this is a good reading.
Now, what I'd like you to do, we're going to be here again, same time, after 6 o'clock at night. So you get a longer conversation. But 6 o'clock at night in 2 weeks.
Call in, brother.
Another bulletin on the internet.
Hey, yeah, it's all over. It's on Twitter. It's on Facebook. It's on Truth Social.
That's my Facebook. Okay.
Then. Yes. Look at the sharing of information. You chose to connect with that number and call in. That's brilliant.
Let me tell you another way to do it. All right. Write this down. Bob.
Wait, Charles. Hold on. Let me get my pen, man.
Hurry up. Get that pen.
Hold on. Okay. Okay. Well, one second, Bob. Okay, wait, I got, hold on.
You're fine, Jason.
But Bob Charles,
Bob Charles Show, SHOW, at.
I got you.
Live, LIVE, .com.
Okay.
Now, you take that address, right? You send me anything, a blank email, if you want to. And I will send you a copy of all the information of where to listen to us, where to listen to all the shows, the telephone numbers, the text numbers, the chat rooms, the whole thing.
Okay.
And then you can tell everybody you know, like, hey, come in here. These guys will talk to you. Sure, we will.
Yeah. And look, you had enough guts to do this, Jason. You didn't have to. You weren't made to. You were allowed to.
Yeah.
That is the connection of co-creation, not manipulation. That's beautiful. And thanks for being you, Jason.
Okay. Well, thank you. I'll make a note of that.
You are the man. God bless. God bless.
Lots of love.
Thank you very much.
All right. Awesome. Now,
all right. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye now. Now, meanwhile, back at the ranch, we is like out of here. And let me tell you something. The man is a man. You know, it's one of these things. Hey, listen. You know, as many people that say, well, you know, I went out with this one here and I said, look, man, love is a two-way street. Now, let's go back to the other part. It depends upon which side you on. Side, your side. If you're on your side, you're like him. Hey, use them and abuse them or whatever. And the other side, when they're on your side, they're keepers.
And isn't it interesting? What if love allows all of this stuff to be?
It does.
No.
It does. It all depends upon what you take it. Or see, openness of people are 99% of a relationship. And people don't even know what openness is.
Well, sometimes they're afraid of that. It's not comfortable for everyone.
No. but you see, the idea or the thing is, look, even if you don't like what the other person is going to say, one way or the other, you can, I mean, you look, you can be Trump on the other hand. Let's make a deal. You know, it's like, hey, all right, if that's what you don't like about me, or you don't like that I did, or you don't like that I said, or something like that, then I just won't do it anymore. Is that okay with you?
And
if I do say something like that, or I do it, remind me. Bingo. I mean, it's very, very easy. I mean, relationships are machines. They really, really do. It's like two glasses on these frames that we're looking through. If one doesn't work, the other one won't work either. Why? Because they're the wrong glasses. It's just like the same thing with a girlfriend. If it's the wrong girlfriend, she won't work. You know what I mean? And look.
See it clearly, yeah.
Mechanics, you can get mechanic with sexes and the whole nine yards, and a little bit of this, a little bit of that, a little bit of the other thing. But look, if the keepers are the ones that you're to make love to someone, you are part of that person. Your soul and their soul are one. At that point,
and the physical bodies merge. Yeah.
The ones, right? The ones that are mechanic are two separate entities. Getting gratification for themselves, not for each other, but for themselves, and that's a whole another ball game. Now, if you want to learn how to love, you've got to go through a whole bunch of things first before you get to the one you go, I get it.
Whatever it takes. Yeah.
I mean, today with things that are going on and all this digital garbage and everything else and that, I mean, let's face it. I mean, love is a little bit harder. It is. And the first thing that people are meeting, when we used to meet a long time ago, there were things we used to meet in bars, restaurants, the parks, you know, all kinds of places, work, you know, a billion places that you could meet. And the meeting would be somebody that would come up to somebody else and say, hey, listen, why don't we do coffee? Or somebody was talking about a subject. Hey, let's talk about that some more. And then for some reason, they found a common thread in the relationship. And that thread grew and made them, the two people, one person. On the other hand, then you have the ones that are the I would say, playing baseball, you know, playing the field kind of thing. Hey, listen, you want some gratification? Let's go. Cars over there. It's like, it's crazy, but it's true, you know. And yep. You know, we are silly people. We really, really are. And you know, even though we're silly, we all have hearts. And the thing that I always say to people all the time is, this is what counts in me. You know, you can do anything to me. You can say anything. You can do anything. You can do anything. You can say anything about me. The whole nine yards. But this thing that's down here will love you anyway, eternally. Why? Because it's my heart.
And if we as humans can do it, do you really think the universe?
Yes. Which is connected to my heart. Thank you.
All one. Yes, sir.
Yeah. Oh, hey, we're good. Let me get us out of here in style.
Always great, Bob.
We're awesome. What can you tell? You always say what I say at the end of the show. I always say it. People actually write me in and say, you want to say that while we're on the phone? Yeah. God bless you all. Bob Charles. Out.